Welcome to the Real Estate Syndication Show. Whether you are a seasoned investor or building a new real estate business, this is the show for you. Whitney Sewell talks to top experts in the business. Our goal is to help you master real estate syndication. And now your host, Whitney Sewell.
This is your daily real estate syndication show. I'm your host, Whitney Sewell. Today, our guest is Peter Badger. Thanks for being on the show again, Peter.
Pleasure, Whitney. Always great to be here.
And Peter was a guest on show 652. We talked about building wealth through a global investor alliance. I encourage you to go back and listen to that show. But he's an avid real estate investor and educator. And with his partner, Karen, they invest mainly in U.S. multifamily and overseas agriculture. Real estate investing and education is their full-time endeavor and quenches their thirst for service, global travel, and adventure. Peter, welcome back to the show. And want us to quickly dive in and we'll get some of your thoughts about the maybe current situation, the pandemic, and you know your syndication stuff. We're going to dive into thinking about farmland. I know you're doing overseas farmland, and wow, it seems like such a big endeavor to me. You know, not thinking about something like that before, and very few guests, have talked about overseas farmland. So, looking forward to getting into that and maybe opening the listeners' minds a little bit to a different opportunity that are potential there. But why don't you get us started and where you all are at right now in your multifamily syndications and the pandemic, all that stuff, and let's jump in.
Yeah, it's an interesting time, to say the least. So our portfolio has weathered the storm, literally. I think for us, so we kind of focus, we talk about our Maslow's hierarchy of needs investing strategy. And so obviously in the Maslow's hierarchy of need, at the bottom is food and shelter. And that's really been our approach for the past 8 to 10 years. And broadly, the shelter is multifamily in the US and strong markets, good job growth and all the statistics I talked about in the last episode. We talked about this stuff. And then the other side is the food, because, we're 7.5 billion going up to 9 billion people, and there's never going to be an end to the need to supply people with nutritious food, mostly fruit, vegetables in our space. It's been a crazy year, honestly. And I would say that we've paused our multifamily investing since March. And predominantly that's because you can't really peg valuations. You can't value these deals at the moment because there's so much uncertainty. There's an eviction moratorium. There's a lot of unemployment. This stuff all has to play out. Whether there's a second stimulus bill or not, I think you'll agree, Whitney. It's like, it doesn't matter that the economy is broken unevenly, hospitality, travel, leisure, as you say in American. But generally it's concerning right now to turn around and say, okay, I can value this building at X based upon these rents, because we just have to wait for this thing to play out a bit more in 2021. So, I'm not sure if you found that with your other guests in the multifamily space.
Yeah, I find it's kind of all over the place, honestly. Some are like, no, it's time to find deals. And others, like yourself, are, wait a minute, how do we know what this is worth? I've heard it back and forth, both ways. I know the listeners have as well. A couple of things I wanted to point out, though, just what you mentioned there. You've pulled back from multifamily, but you didn't just say, we're going to just sit over here and wait. You did find another option or another way to keep investing. And I love how, your thought behind like food and shelter. We all have to have it, right? Yeah. Both of those things are so important. And I wanted to ask you too, before we move on, is just, you talked about your portfolio has weathered the storm, and maybe you could just provide one or two things that you put in place when you either purchased the property or through the deal or whatever that has helped you to now weather the storm before we move on to a different opportunity that you're investing in now.
Yeah, no, it's a great question, Whitney, because I think one of the things some people don't understand, especially if they're new investors, is what your behavior should be, or what the behavior of a syndication leads, in the case of multifamily, should be during these, let's call them recessionary periods or uncertain periods. And really, I tell people that their goal for me as an investor and for our investors is capital preservation. So when the markets are good, make the property perform, keep raising the rents, rehabbing, raise the value of that building, give us higher cash flow, and improve the appreciation of the building itself. But once that market turns, I care lesser about the profit side of things. To me, it's about keeping occupancy up. It's about making sure that our buildings are, you know, 85 to 95% occupied throughout that dip as we go back into the next cycle. And so this is what's occurred in pandemic world. You know, we originally in our investment models require the syndicator to demonstrate to us, especially in recent history, okay, what if we have another dip like 2008? In your market, what was the lowest occupancy level for those zip codes we're investing in? How does the model perform during that period? And therefore, how much cash is in the bank to get you through that? And so obviously, with that going in, we've been fortunate because our buildings have mostly been B class. So our tenants have been working from home. We're not in the C class, where there's a lot more, let's call it frontline workers who are suffering economically with job loss and requiring stimulus. So our portfolio has weathered the storm, but generally, you know, I implore people as a multifamily investor, make sure that your syndication leads know they're supposed to preserve your capital during these periods, because that's all that matters. If you can weather this storm, preserve the capital, come out the other side, and then make more profits going forward. And that's really the only goal of these people at this point.
Capital preservation, no doubt about it. It's so important. And your operator or your syndicator better have that on top of their mind, right? Yeah. And I love, you know, just some of the points there you mentioned too, just keeping 85 to 90% occupied through the dip. You know, what were the occupancies at the worst time, you know, in 2008, 9, whatever, you know, and how, if that happened again, how are we going to be performing? You know, what's, you know, how's the operator prepared for that? Some great thoughts. Well, you know, you've taken a shift too, Peter, and you're doing some a new asset class. And, you know, let's jump into that. Give us kind of a feel for what this is, and then we'll jump into some of the risk metrics and different things like that, so the listener and myself can just learn more about this and maybe even consider it as an opportunity.
Yeah, so let's jump into the farmland side of things. So we kind of stumbled on it, you know, in all honesty, because you invest in stuff where you are networking and people around you who are into the same things. So fortunately, we were digital nomads for 3 or 4 years. We traveled the world and we were doing real estate, a lot of short-term rental, you know, looking for lifestyle investments, let's call it, to enhance the multifamily in the US. And we started seeing agriculture pop up everywhere. And there's kind of, there's two flavors of it broadly. There's either the syndication, just like a value add, people will take a large plot of land in Central South America. They'll, you know, lay the irrigation, clear it of trees. They'll then plant a crop and they'll wait for a few years for the crop to grow and et cetera, et cetera. And that's the syndication side, just like a value add multifamily, but you're producing fruit and vegetables instead of, you know, tenanted multifamily buildings. On the other side of that is land owned or titled in your name. And so you can go to certain operators who will have done that, that have produced the crop, it'll be income producing, then they'll basically divide that up into titled hectares, which is 2.2 acres for people who aren't into hectares, and they'll basically then sell you that land income producing at that time. And that's a way for them to, you know, because you think about this life cycle here, patient capital invests in the bare land, waits for the 4, 5, 6 years for that crop to grow, and then they can resell that later for profit to that patient capital coming at the start of the syndication. So kind of think of it in two buckets, syndicated value add, just like multifamily, and or titled income producing hectares in their own right.
Nice. It's so interesting. You know, are you participating in both sides of that, you know, or is that something you're active in?
Yeah, we are. And actually, we were patient capital in a bunch of deals up front, actually. And we are also now brokering some of those lots on the back end because we've sat there for 4 or 5 years waiting for that crop to grow. And we're wanting to actually help our position as an LP in a syndication deal to then actually help the investment, you know, investors realize some of the profits. And more importantly, to share that. We're trying to kind of make sure that everybody can access it, because there's also two sides to think about here, depending on where you are as a listener. In a syndication, all of these things are still within the SEC purview Therefore, you have to be accredited. But with titled farmland, it's just like buying real estate, just like buying a house. And so you can take title, you can be a non-accredited investor. So our goal is, as both, you know, LPs and investors ourselves, is to basically try and democratize farmland ownership. And we'll talk about that in a second, because from my perspective, it's like you have to go through this journey of understanding the risks and returns of these asset classes. And to me, I kind of like have gone up the chain over the years. You know, single family homes, most people back into a 8% cap rate or return. You're going to value add multifamily, you can squeeze out 15 to 20%. And so where does agriculture fit in that scale? Well, honestly, syndications can match multifamily, go even higher, depending on where they are in Central South America, for instance. And then like a single family home, when you buy productive farmland, you can expect 11 to 15 to 17% year on year for decades. And there's, you know, it's not all these things like you buy a single family home, oh, I mean, your roof probably has what, 20, 25, 30 years max. In farmland, you plant a coconut tree, it'll last for 40 to 60 years. You know, there's no tenants moving out, trashing your farm. You know, there's no major rehab costs for tenant turnover. There's, you know, it's basically, the key to think about it is as I go up the different asset classes, I kind of kept getting advice from different people, experts in this space. And they were like, listen, you know, single family home, you've got to maintain all this infrastructure for one family. Multifamily, you scale, don't you? Your expenses spread across a number of apartment units. Even better is mobile home parks, because in most cases, it's a concrete pad with utility hookups. And you get up to farmland, which actually is a bare plot of land. You plant it and you're really maintaining the crop. And so there's no, you know, roofs, air conditioners, you know, the three T's, tenants, trash and toilets. So it is a very different asset class with different risks, which we can talk through today really about the risk.
Yeah. I want us to jump into that because I want us to be able to hammer out some risks. But you're doing this internationally, right? You're not doing it. Why internationally and not in the U.S.?
Multiple reasons. The two predominant ones are the cost of land is so much cheaper overseas, and the cost of labor is so much cheaper overseas. And so the weird thing is that there is a ton of farming overseas. The problem is there's no way for them to get that crop to our markets where it's you know, most profitable. And so what we do is we look for operators who operate in Central South America, cheap land, cheap labor, you know, multi-generational farming. It's all there in the right climate, avoiding the hurricane belt, for instance. But then also we can then take that produce, pack it, put it through shipping in containers up to markets in Europe, US, wherever we can get the most profit for it. And really what we're doing again is we're not only trying to democratize the ownership of farmland generally from a purchase standpoint, we're also trying to help these farmers earn more money locally because their crop can actually command much higher prices in Europe and the US.
Nice. Well, let's jump into some of the risks, risk metrics, just so, you know, the listener and myself can be thinking through these things as maybe we're thinking about investing, you know, in this way.
Yeah. So I think for me, we had to create our own risk matrix. If you're in the multifamily space, you all know how to value it. There are standard spreadsheets. You can pull them down from the internet. You know, yes, they require a bit of finagling, but people generally understand that the value of a multifamily building is related to the net operating income. And you can back into the right numbers and value stuff. And you can then model out those risks based upon population growth, job growth, all those metrics, crime rates, you name it. So the key to investing agriculture is it's like investing in any private company. And so we actually built a 10-point risk matrix. And it was around, you know, bucket one was 3 years around product. You know, what is the crop you're going to be producing? You know, you want to understand the market price history and projections, like rent projections. What's your market price and history and projections of your crop? And maybe we'll talk about a couple of crops like coconuts and limes as an example. as the example here. So you can go out to major websites, public websites, and you can look, for instance, on the Rungis wholesale market in Paris, how much, you know, the price of a kilo of limes is this week. And so you can start to basically trust and verify the data. You know, you'll be given a syndication model or a farmland ownership model, and you're looking for the price of the fruit. What's their assumption of the price of that fruit averaged throughout the year? Because it's seasonal. And you can kind of go out there and verify that data against known public sources of true, you know, kilos of lime pricing on the internet. And so, you know, in that product area is the growth and yield cycles. How long does it take since you plant a lime tree versus a coconut tree to produce the initial crop and then mature the full crop? What diseases are there? Longevity of transport and storage. You know, coconuts is so versatile. You can like get green coconuts. They can be mature coconuts. They can last a long time compared to citrus fruits. You've probably got, you know, 18 to 30 days to transport them from the farm to the market to sell. You can put them in cold storage, you know, last up to 60 days if you put them the right temperature. But there's all these things around the product you need to consider from that side. And, you know, sales, distribution, branding, you know, the transport, logistics, trade and customs. How do you actually make sure that you can actually get your crop from Colombia or Panama through the port system into the US or Europe?
That's something the operator better have figured out, right?
This is right. And so we have all these areas that you can ask those questions. And you know, as always, only use operators who have done it before. Look for the track record.
Yeah.
And that's the key to this thing. So that's kind of the bucket one. What product are you into and what are the pros and cons of that product from a farming, sales and distribution standpoint?
Wow. Okay. You know, what about, are any other risk metrics that are just key to you, Peter, that we, you know, we need to just know that we need to ask that operator about?
Yeah. So the second major bucket for us is the investment itself, you know, the country or the region, you know, obviously political stability, you know, don't buy farmland in Venezuela. No, that's a cheap offer of advice there. You know, economic, you know, aspects around the currency. You know, so Panama is in USD. There's going to be currency risk depending on certain countries. There's climate, environmental, the weather, you know, avoiding, you know, I do Central South America because the hurricane belt comes around the Caribbean and sweeps up the east coast of the US. It doesn't hit, you know, Colombia. It doesn't hit Panama. That's just one of the great things about those locations. Plentiful water sources. Has to be the right point on the planet, you know, equator. Has to be in the certain areas where we're going to get plentiful water, decent soils, etc. You know, another reason we don't invest in the US, by the way, is because the soil's been ruined by big ag, by pesticides, by over-farming. You know, so you've got to go in places where we can guarantee better soils and better care of the land, so to speak. And then, you know, investment structure, jurisdiction, the banking, you know, ownership structure. Is this a Cayman entity or is it a Delaware made, you know, normal for US investors? There's all these aspects around the investment itself. And of course, you know, all the regular financial aspects of, you know, the project distributions timeline, capital buffer, you know, the returns you're expecting. Is it value add or steady annuity stream for 60 years? So there's a big bucket around the investment itself and those aspects. And then, you know, finally, the big third bucket is the team, as always. I tell people you are not making an investment in anything other than the people. Because honestly, they're the ones who have the experience, multi-generational farming experience. They understand how to do all the transport, trade, customs, logistics, how to sell in certain markets. And they have that track record or they don't. They have the language, the culture, the location. You know, I would not deal with a you know, sorry to put in these terms, but a local team who has no English and or no expectation what American investors require. So I'm looking for those dual nationals, I'm looking for, you know, Colombian born who have been educated in the US, understand what our expectations are in terms of what an investment should look like or a purchase of land sale. And they then go back down to their home country they're culturally adept at fitting in, making sure they don't get, you know, taken for a ride, you know, the gringo effect, I call it. And so you're looking for those kind of like, you know, let's say mixed culture individuals with the American aspect of knowing how to build businesses and show these investments. So that's the big third bucket, the team, as always.
It's so crucial. And I tell everyone, you know, you're investing in the operator more than anything else. It doesn't, I mean, the deal is so important, but it's so secondary, you know, to the operator. And we have about a minute per, if we're going to go through 10 of these, we got just about a minute per for the rest of them. I want the listeners to be able to hear each of these, at least so they'll have questions and they'll know to ask questions about each of these points.
Yeah, no. So I jammed the first nine in those three big buckets.
Okay.
So it's great, you know, it's product, investment, team, they're the big three areas. And you know, we built a model, we built, you know, a bunch of stuff around this because you truly are valuing these ag investments like a private company. And therefore you need to do the due diligence in these separate areas. And obviously it's like anything else. You do one, you're a bit rocky, you're a bit rusty, you're learning. That's why I have an alliance of members, because we kind of do it together and, you know, bring in different aspects of knowledge. And then you just keep stamping them out. And over time, you'll see patterns. You'll start to see which operators are understanding the products and the crop they're producing, the pros and cons. You'll see the aspects around the deal structure. You'll see around the documentation. You know, look for American-style legal documentation. Make sure you're looking, if you're in a Spanish-speaking country, at both documents. You want to see the base document in Spanish against applicable law in that country where that purchase or investment is. And more importantly, see a verified translation into English so you can follow it if you don't speak or read Spanish. So there is some other angles to this, but that's why we kind of like have strong operators. We have a good team with us, our alliance members, to kind of look at these deals holistically to make sure we're investing the right thing.
What about pros and cons of just being an international investor, Peter? You know, we work with lots of international investors that are investing with us, you know, in multifamily. However, you know, thinking about, you know, me investing in another country and their farmland, things like that, what are some pros and cons to that?
Yeah, so we actually stumbled on this ag bucket because we love to travel. And so we enjoy the fact that we can go out a couple of trips a year, Central South America, visit our existing investments and look for new ones. And so if you have a thirst for travel, then it's great because, you know, I'm not the kind of guy who can sit on the beach for 8 hours a day. You know, I'm just not that person. I mean, maybe my English complexion, I burn. But the point is to actually combine global travel with your investing is our joy, and that's what we're passionate about. So you have to want that. You know, to your point, I've met many of our, you know, a few of our alliance members don't want to travel internationally. That's okay. You know, they want to see their investment in US dollars, in markets they know, like Cincinnati, Ohio, or, you know, Austin, Texas, or Tampa, Florida. That's where they want to stay, and that's where they want to go to occasionally and check out their investments and make sure it's all okay. We have a other wide range of people. Our investor group are all over the world. You know, they're in Colombia directly. They're in Panama. They're in Canada, UK, Australia, all over the world, France, you name it, Singapore. And they're the ones predominantly with a good, so as I said, the American investors who want to combine travel with investing. And you've got to go down there, okay? Either you go down and see these investments or you have a trusted third party. So me and Karen play it for some of our members who don't want to travel, who haven't got the time to travel. You know, they're cash rich, time poor. They've got these big corporate jobs, they're building their own companies. We'll head down there, we'll video these things. And really, like any investment or any purchase of overseas real estate, you know, you wouldn't buy a condo and not see it, would you? Well, some people do, foolishly, but you shouldn't, is my point. Put your feet on the ground, meet the operator, shake them in the hand, look them in the eye, meet the farm management team, you know. You'll meet like Melanio, who runs our coconut farm in Monterrey, Colombia. And he actually was born on a coconut farm. His dad was a coconut farmer. And so you want to see these things in this kind of, you know, realm. And you can only do that by being there in person.
You know, I'm probably going to ask you this, Peter, but, you know, just preparing for a downturn with farmland, international farmland like this, what does a downturn look like? You know, farming, I think all of us, you know, whether you've lived on a farm or not, you just think of how risky it is, you know, farming. And however, you know, maybe you can speak to that and just being prepared for some kind of downturn with international farmland.
Yeah, so you have to consider it slightly differently in this realm. So what is our business model for these things? So like multifamily, you have, you know, Class C student housing, you know, senior living. You have all these like flavors of real estate. It's the same in ag and farmland. So what do? We look for high quality fruit in premium markets. So just in the same way that my people in my multifamily buildings right now are in Class B working from home, a lot of them are not impacted too badly by this pandemic. They're working for corporations. They're able to do that. They have the luxury of that. We are, as an example, selling high-end, high-quality limes to the wholesale markets in Berlin, Paris. You know, we even actually distribute them to Walmart. And so honestly, there's always a demand for high-quality fruit in high-end customer wholesale or retail realms. And so to us, we're not looking to, you know, produce billions of fruits a year like the big people. You know, we're not a big banana producer. You know, very slim margins. We're taking extremely high color, juicy Colombian limes, shipping them 2 or 3 containers a week to Walmart on the East Coast to basically be repackaged and distributed through their stores. And so honestly, there's always a need for that kind of fruit and at that scale. So look for the investments where they are really looking for the high-end premium consumer. And that's how you avoid that downturn.
And I know we've talked about this a little bit, your shift from multifamily to overseas farmland, but what do you predict to happen over the next 6 to 12 months just in the real estate market? And you can speak to that to international farmland or local, you know, or U.S. real estate, either one.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not going to predict a thing. I think anybody predicting anything right now would be foolish. You know, I mean,
nobody really knows, right?
In a world none of us understand. You know, the Fed is propping up the entire stock market. It has no connection to reality. You know, I get why there's a bubble in tech stocks and, you know, Zoom and stuff we're going to use and the move to basically accelerating trends. But there's also another side of this market which just hasn't been recognized yet. And so let's see what happens in 2021. It's probably going to take until the end of the year to get the vaccine out, things return back to normal. That's in the developed countries. You know, ignore the developing countries, which is 2022, 2023. Right. And so, yeah, it's going to be a fascinating year next year. And so we're going to basically be hanging there, waiting for those deals. I mean, we're seeing crazy deals already. It's not hitting the press like anything else. You know, the press always reports in the past, you know. If it's in the mainstream media, it's already happened, so you're too late. You know, so we're in investing full time, as many of your listeners probably are. And so, you know, we were offered a hotel in Oklahoma last month, $20 million asset for $3 million.
Wow.
For a reason. You know, so this is starting to play out, hospitality, leisure. Now, do we want to buy that? No, we're not hotel operators. We can't predict how long before these assets can be recovered. And we haven't got those deep pockets to maintain that asset through an uncertain period of time until markets recover, if they recover to previous levels at all in the next 18 months. So sorry, I'm not predicting anything for you, Whitney, but I think for us, we're going to stick to farmland because we've opened up markets for fruit and vegetables, a supply chain, which we can leverage. And that's not going away. In matter of fact, we can't produce enough fruit and vegetables for some of these consumers, wholesale and retail customers. And we're going to sit on the sideline and wait for whatever happens in 2021 for those multifamily deals to appear. Because believe you me, we had a deal fall through in September. The person we were buying it from refused to discount the price by 6% because of the, you know, weakness of the market or the submarket that building was in. And they are leveraged to the hilt. They got in late in the game. And I think if this takes a turn for the worst, those buildings will start to be resold at a discount on the market. So if you've got money in your pocket, keep it in your pocket, wait, because because those deals are going to come, I believe.
Peter, how do you like to give back?
In many ways, let's link it back to agriculture. One of the reasons we do this is because we can go into developing countries. We can actually, for the first time, get an asset-based investment with, you know, deep cash reserves. We can give the workers regular salaries. We can give them workers' comp in case they get injured. We can then start to give back to that local village in terms of providing fresh water sources and various other aspects that they can't rely upon from prior, agricultural capabilities. So yeah, we try and go into these towns and countries and create holistic investments that not only take care of our profits and the consumer purchasing the products, but more importantly, taking care of the families and the towns where these investments and ag deals are located. So that's part of our big deal.
Peter, another great show. Grateful to have you back and really expose us, the listeners and myself, to just a different asset class that maybe we should be considering, asking questions of, finding people like yourself that are experts in this so we can learn and potentially diversify, you know, outside of even the U.S., much less, you know, just multifamily or you know, a specific asset class or even one market. So just grateful for your time in telling us about, you know, your pause on multifamily in the U.S., you know, and thinking through international farmland, but even then, you know, those risks that we need to be thinking through as we're learning about this new asset class, which we have to do for any type of investment. I'm grateful for you just sharing those. That saves us a lot of time having to do the research to find all those things. But tell the listeners how they can get in touch with you and learn more about you.
Yeah, so we are at globalinvestoralliance.com. We actually have a group of investors. You're welcome to join, chat to us about it. But more importantly, we've started democratizing farmland. So you can go to go.buythefarm.net. And there you'll see kind of a way you can get involved in investing in ag and leverage our experience and dip your toe in the water for the first time if you're new to this space and you want to work with us and learn how to invest in ag safely for 40 to 60 years of income, annuity income, which you can live on yourself and pass down to your kids and or heirs. So that's the goal. Go.buythefarm.net.
Thank you for listening to the Real Estate Syndication Show, brought to you by LifeBridge Capital. LifeBridge Capital works with investors nationwide to invest in real estate, while also donating 50% of its profits to assist parents who are committing to adoption. LifeBridge Capital. Making a difference, one investor and one child at a time. Connect online at www.lifebridgecapital.com for free material and videos to further your success.